Let's walk through a couple of examples of using the tree view container. In this first example, we see this very simple application with a tree view container, and as we expand or collapse the nodes, we're adding more data into that tree container. Looking at this form, we see that the tree is defined, and then we see down below that some of the columns are set to phantom so that our screen record can map to our program record, but we don't want to show all the different columns in that container. We also see some of the attributes defined for the tree, such as the images that we want to use. Now, when we look at the source code, at first at the top we see a dynamic array defined for the tree, and you'll see those are the same columns that map to our screen record. Then we're making a call to a function called expand, and the expand function is going to be used to go and get the data, then display that data to the tree. There's also new syntax called onExpand and onCollapse that can be used to trigger a call to a function or some other code to execute based on the expanding, these are expanding or collapsing one of the nodes. Here we're using the ID, the node ID, to indicate which of the nodes has been expanded or collapsed, and that gives us the information that we need in order to know where and how to load and display that data. So you can see in a standard for loop here that we're using the insert element method to insert a new element in the tree based on the positioning when we were called that, that expand function. And then again, the just showing here the collapse as well is similar in that we're deleting elements from the array based on a position of the node that the user clicked on. Let's take a look at another example. In this example, the tree view container has been set up to operate like a start menu. We can see that this tree structure also has a secondary column, ID, being shown or is visible, so it's not phantom. It is visible in the tree container. And as we expand and collapse, we can see additional programs or perhaps programs or actions available for the user to execute. Let's first take a look at the form. So in the form we have our standard edit field in the first position, and then we also have included the ID column. So in this particular example we're showing that column. And in for the other required columns, the parent ID, we're also using exec and some others, we've set those to phantom. But for the ID we've decided instead of creating it as a phantom field, we'll just use a label. Then we can see that there are some attributes again set on the tree for the images we want to use, and we've identified the ID column and the parent column. We've also can use, just like in a table, the double click attribute to indicate what action should be triggered when the user double clicks on a particular node in the tree. Now in the source code we can see that there's a user type of record has been defined, and we've defined that record. Then we have defined an array, dynamic array, from that record. Then as we scroll down, we'll see that there is some data to being created. And then down here in this function, we are loading the array with data from data in the database. And we have a function called fetchChildren that's used to go out and get the data. Then we're displaying our array to our tree array, to our screen array, which was the tree container. Again, you can see the onExpand and onCollapse syntax being used to call the fetch children or collapse children function, which is going to pass the ID of which of those nodes in the tree or which of those elements was selected, and then process accordingly. And here a standard for each is being used to then insert a new element into the array based on the information passed to the function. And we can see the same thing is true for the collapse children function. We're going to delete elements from the array based on the position in the array. And again, this code would be called, this function is called when the user closes a node or collapses a node in the tree. So if we were to run this again, we can see the on expand as well as the collapsing and the information shown to the user. In this last example, we'll take a look at this bill of materials application and see how this tree is structured and implemented. So you can see this particular form has a group box, has a tree container, and then depending what we select in the tree container, that particular information is also identified down in the table at the bottom. In the tree container, there are additional columns being shown, and just like a table, we can move columns around as the user if we turn that, keep those defaults available to the user, and the user can expand and collapse the data, etc. Let's first take a look at the form, and we see that this form has an action default section, a top menu being built. Then when we get down to the layout section, we can see that first there's a grid to the left, which was the buttons that we were showing, and then the tree container. And the tree container has quite a few columns identified. Some of those will be phantom columns, but some of those will just simply be hidden to the user until the user decides to show them. Let's look down in the attributes section, and we see here the tree attributes are defined. Notice that we have the unsortable columns defined. In other words, we don't want the user to be able to sort, but we have the parent ID and ID identified, the images, as well as the double click set to an action called show part. Then we've got our edit field and then our phantom fields. And our screen record defined down at the bottom that includes all of those fields. And again, some of those are phantom fields. Now, if we take a look at the source code, we'll see that we have a record defined for the tree. Here it's called T underscore BOM tree, bill of materials tree. And it includes everything that we saw in that form. Now we'll define a dynamic array based on that record that was defined. So we have a dynamic array called BOM list. And as we look through this code, we can see that we're going to fill that tree with data. So first we go out and fill it the root sort of levels of information that's needed. And then as the user expands or collapses a section, we are going to retrieve and display additional information. So we've declared a cursor. Now we're just going to pass each of the rows from the cursor set into our array and display that information. Here in our large dialog statement, we have a couple of display array statements. Here's our display array, the BOM list to the tree view. There's our tree view screen record there. And you can see our display array there to the standard table as well. So very standard syntax, whether you're working with a table or with a tree view. And then here we have all of our actions listed, all of the things that the user can do. And you'll note that in some of the instances there, we are getting the current row in the tree view, or we may be inserting, calling a function that's going to insert a new row, etc. And just to run this program again, we can see that as we select something from the bill of materials list, it's highlighted down in the table as well. So many uses for a tree view container, and again, built into the language is the syntax on expand and on collapse that will allow you to trap that action by the user and to process accordingly.